Good morning to all of you. Till now we have been handling simulation of very simple equipment or unit models like mixer, splitter, component separator, pumps, things like that. Now I'd like to go into a heat exchanger and try to show you the power of Aspen in designing the heat exchanger in complete detail. Now we have already seen what is meant by a heater model. Again, this could be a preliminary process model, quite useful while making mass and energy balances, especially when you are dealing with preliminary process design calculations. Now, as you have pointed out earlier with respect to component separator, this heater model also will not be able to identify what type of equipment you are using, nor the size of the equipment. Now, I may be particularly interested in designing a shell and tube heat exchanger. Now let me take up with this example, and in fact while demonstrating this example I would like to do it in two parts. I would like to make use of the conventional model available under Aspen to do or to find out the design of such a heat exchanger, and later I'll be able to use a specific module available under Aspen using which you will be able to go into rigorous design calculations, including the design drawings. Now, in earlier versions of Aspen, it is being called as task. Now, in the present version, this particular aspect, the design of heat exchanger, is given under exchanger design and rating, EDR. Now, let us go ahead with demonstrating this problem. Now, as you can see, there are two streams, freon and ethylene glycol. Now the flow rates, temperatures are given. There is some kind of a pressure drop recommended on both shell side and tube side. Now let me try to formulate this problem by going into Aspen. Now the two components that you are going to handle happen to be freon. This is the molecular formula for freon 12, and then ethylene glycol. These are the only two components we are handling in the process. Now let me go into the next input screen. Now choose a property method. Let us say I am interested in choosing another property method just to show you the variation. UNIFAC. Say next. Now I go to simulation environment. Now I can define the problem, draw the flow sheet. So click on exchangers, select the heat exchanger model. Now I would like to connect the material streams. Now you can observe this is the input for the cold stream. So in other words, this is the cold stream inlet and this would be the cold stream outlet. Obviously this is on the tube side by default. Now the hot stream inlet and the hot stream outlet. For convenience, let me rename these streams cold in cold out. Hot in and hot out. Okay, if you want you can also rename the block. Now let us go into the next input screen. Now remember, once again you may be handling a rating model, so the requirement is both the input streams, cold in and hot in, must be specified. No information is being sought with respect to the output streams, and some information may be required with respect to the block. Now let me provide the same information. Temperature of the cold stream inlet is 240 Kelvin. The pressure is 7 atmospheres. And the flow rate, now remember, the cold stream is a pure component, pure freon. So the flow rate in terms of kg per hour is 10,560, right? So how many specifications we have provided here? 3, temperature, pressure and the flow rate. So because this contains only one component, the degrees of freedom is 1 plus 2, 3. Now we have satisfied that. That means we have specified cold in. Now let us go to the next input screen. Now the hot stream inlet is at 350 Kelvin, a pressure of 2 atmospheres, and it is of course pure ethylene glycol, but do we know the flow rate? Now as you know, without specifying the flow rate, we will not be able to go ahead. So even though we are handling some kind of an analysis problem, because we know the outlet temperature of this hot fluid is to be at 320 Kelvin. Now unfortunately, that cannot be provided as one of the inputs while specifying the stream. So let me make an assumption with respect to its flow rate. Some wild guess, let us say something like 10,000 kg per hour, because the other stream is entering at the rate of 10,560. Now this is approximated. We will try to review this once we run the simulation in rating mode. Let us say go to next screen. Now you have number of options. Now if you want to design the equipment using this conventional model available under Aspen, only shortcut design is permissible. The moment you go into detail, design is not permissible, but you will be able to make certain detailed rating calculations. Now we'll be able to go into rigorous design calculations. As I said, I will be demonstrating this once I complete the shortcut design using the conventional model available under Aspen. Now in addition to whatever is given here, now I am required to specify one more detail. Now you should be able to specify at least one of these values. Now I know the cold stream outlet temperature, it should be heated from 240 to 300 Kelvin. So I am providing that here. Now without specifying this outlet temperature, the model will not be able to establish what is the heat duty involved. Whether it is getting cooled or heated, it should be able to calculate how much heat must be supplied by the other utility or other process stream. Now in order to do this, at least three temperatures must be known to us. Then based on that, you will be able to calculate the other temperature. Anyway, now we were able to specify the block. The required input is complete. So we will be able to run the simulation. Okay. You can look at the stream summary. Now as you can see, these are the inlet and outlet temperatures. Now we wanted the hot stream outlet temperature to be at 320 Kelvin. That means it should be around 47 degrees centigrade. But because we have made an assumption with respect to its flow as 10,000 kg per hour, now you may have to review this figure in order to match with the requirement of maintaining 320 Kelvin with respect to the hot stream outlet. Now that we will see slightly later. Now why I am calling this as a shortcut design is because of this reason. Now you can see the report. Before going into those details, I would like to see the block report. Now these are the mass and energy balances. Unlike the case of heater, now even the energy balance is satisfied. Whereas in the case of a heater, the energy balance is giving quite a large difference. This is essentially because we are not addressing where from which stream is actually adding or removing the required heat as per the energy balance. That's why there could be a difference in energy balance with respect to a heater. Now, in the case of a heat exchanger, there cannot be any difference. In the same way, let us see this. Now, this is a pictorial representation of your problem. The input streams are mentioned. Now we were able to calculate the output streams. Now let us see what kind of design calculations it has done. The heat duty is computed. The calculated area is known. Then you will also be able to see what is the log mean temperature difference and LMTD correction factor. Now what do you mean by this area? Why I am calling this as some kind of a shortcut design? The reason is this. Now I'll press on this block twice. I'll be able to go into the details of block. In fact, if you want to modify any data, you can do it this way. Now let us look at what was the overall heat transfer coefficient. Now as you can observe, the overall heat transfer coefficient should be mentioned. If you don't mention, Aspen for all problems, when you especially use this model, will make use of the same value of U. Now, in other words, this can be considered as a shortcut design. You will be able to calculate the heat transfer area provided you specify the overall heat transfer coefficient. But without, in the case of a design of a heat exchanger, now this is a typical problem. To start with, I may not be able to know the value of overall heat transfer coefficient. And as you are already aware, the design of a heat exchanger is an iterative process. You may have to start with an assumed value for overall heat transfer coefficient, make some estimate with respect to the size and shape of the exchanger, then recalculate using the available correlations, recalculate the value of overall heat transfer coefficient, compare the assumed value with the calculated value. If these two things are comparable, or if they are close together, then probably you have achieved your design. Otherwise, you may have to start with the new value of U, and once again decide the size or calculate the size and shape of the exchanger. Then once again you are required to re-estimate. So this is an iterative process. Now in this respect, this model only calculates the heat transfer area given the overall heat transfer coefficient. And you might have observed, is there any possibility for mentioning the pressure drop? Of course, I did not go into those details, but you can, if you want, specify the pressure drops that are permissible by defining here both with respect to hot side and cold fluid. Now, anyway, let me not go into these details because this is only a preliminary model. Now, when we go into rigorous design calculations, we will try to incorporate some of those details. Still, the problem is not completely addressed because we started with an assumption for the hot fluid inlet flow rate, right, which gave us some temperature, but not as per our requirement. The temperature of the hot fluid should have been at 47 degrees, whereas because we started with an assumption of 10,000 kg per hour with respect to the hot fluid flow rate, now the temperature is not matching with this requirement. In order to meet this requirement, now, as you are already aware, you can use one of those tools, typically design specs. I expand the flow sheeting options, click on design spec, say new, okay. So what is the measured variable that we would like to have a target with? That is what is meant by define, say new. Now this is hot stream outlet temperature. Now this hot stream outlet temperature, I am required to drive it to a particular value. Now it's a stream variable. Again, select stream variable. Stream is hot out. Variable is temperature. So whatever name that you have given here is now associated with, this is going to represent the temperature of the hot stream outlet. Now remember, be careful about these units. Now let me handle, let us say, in degree Celsius. Now go to next. Now what is our target with respect to this hot stream outlet temperature? As we already know, this should be at 47 degrees centigrade. Tolerance, some small value, right? So we were able to define our specification. Next. What is the manipulated variable? Because we started with an assumption with respect to the hot stream inlet temperature. Now by manipulating that flow rate, inlet flow rate, now I would like to achieve the desired target with respect to the hot stream outlet temperature. Now what kind of a variable is this? Again, it's a stream variable. What stream? Hot stream inlet. What is the variable? Mass flow. Now the lower limit, let us say, is something like 5,000 to about 50,000. Now we were able to specify the manipulated variable. Let us say, go to next. Okay. Now you can look at the design spec results. Now, when you started with an initial value of 10,000, the temperature of the hot stream outlet temperature is 51.95, about 52, whereas when the flow rate is 8371 or 8372, the temperature was 47, which is going to meet with our requirement. So this is what we are interested in. We should be using a flow rate of 8371.93 kg per hour for the hot stream inlet temperature. Now I would like to use this value to avoid the repetition of calculations. I am deleting this. Let us say I would like to copy this particular value. Now delete design spec. Now go to main flow sheet. Now I am redefining the value of the hot stream inlet flow rate as 8371.93 as was computed from design spec. Now let me run it once again. And see the stream summary. Now the temperature is at 47, right? Now this is one part of the problem. Now you can understand what is the limitation of designing using this model in Aspen. You are only designing a shortcut design based on a given value for overall heat transfer coefficient. Now let me show you how to handle a rigorous design using, as I said, exchanger design and rating option that is available under Aspen. I'll go to the main flow sheet, click on this exchanger. Now I would like to go into rigorous design calculations of shell and tube, right? Say next. Now in this case, you will be asked to specify a file name for import existing EDR input file, exchanger design and rating input file. Let us say some file name. Say next. Okay. Yeah, you were able to get some results. Now before I actually show you, go into this heat exchanger. This is launch the Aspen Exchanger Design and Rating Program to perform rigorous design and rating of heat exchangers. Now we are going to use the CM.data that has been provided in this block B1 under Aspen to size the exchanger using this exchanger design and rating. You were able to calculate some details. Let us go into these details now. Now try to be careful, and it may take quite an amount of time to address some of the issues it was able to go into details. Now for example, this is the summary. TEMA type. Do you know what is meant by TEMA? Tubular Exchangers Manufacturers Association. Now I'll go into one by one. Let us say the input, what we have given, let us see what will happen. In fact, if you want, you can give a heading so that the same heading is printed in your report. Process data. Now you can see consolidated. I think the unit system is slightly different here. Let me choose SI. Metric, kg per hour, 10,560, 8372. Now the temperatures with respect to the hot in is 340, so 76.85, cold in minus 33.15, right? And similarly, the operating pressures, let us change this to atmospheres, 2, and the operating pressure on the cold side is 7. Now we can modify the problem statement. By default, it might have been using some pressure drops, but we can specify. I'll come to that allowable pressure drop. Now you will be able to specify as per your problem statement. Now, according to your problem statement, this should have been 0.67 atmospheres. And this also should have been 0.67 atmospheres. Now we can modify some of that data. In fact, this will get change the outlet temperature based on this slightly later, right? Now this is the process data that we have provided. Now you can also look at the property data. Now, what is the hot stream composition it contains? Okay, let us see hot stream properties. Now, this is the best thing that Aspen can perform, or such a complicated design can be performed using this model. Now, the temperature range is divided into certain number of points. Now, all the properties like liquid density, liquid specific heat, liquid viscosity, liquid thermal conductivity, all these variables are being calculated as a function of temperature in each of these temperature zones. Now, in fact, if you want, you can change this number depending on your requirement. You can either increase the number of intervals or decrease the number of intervals. Now, you will be able to see substantial change in the liquid density from 1170 to about 1071. Similarly, how the liquid specific heat is changing across these temperatures, specific heat, how is it going to change, so on. You can see there is quite a lot of change in specific heat and some of these properties. And if you are trying to conventionally design your heat exchanger, at what temperature you will be evaluating these properties? Most often, we may be taking an average temperature between the inlet and outlet and calculate all these properties at that single temperature. And this alone probably can result in quite a lot of error. Now, not only this, it will also be calculating in zonal basis for each of these temperature ranges, what is the actual amount of heat transfer occurred. We will go into those details as we progress. Now, you can also see in the same way cold stream properties. Now, the cold stream properties are also divided into certain number of points. There can be a phase change, as you can see. During this temperature, it may be as a liquid, and over a particular temperature, it may become even a vapor. Now, accordingly, the properties are calculated. Now, you can see the exchanger geometry. Now, we were able to, did we specify what type of front end, what type of shell type, what type of rear head we are going to use? By default, it has selected a particular type of front end, a particular type of shell type, a particular type of rear head. If you are interested, you need to, you can change some of these, but all possible combinations might not work, as I have already told you. You can see some of these details here. Okay, I'll come back to that slightly later. Now, this is the, by default, the program has selected a particular type of heat exchanger. Now, in the same way, you can see what are the types of tubes. Now, by default, we are using a triangular pitch. The tube pitch is selected by default. Now, if you want to change, you will be able to modify the pitch to different other values. Now, we will come to some of those variations as we progress. Now, in the same way, baffles and supports. Now, single segmental, double segmental, triple segmental, unbaffled, so on. So, by default, single segmental baffle is selected. Some baffle cut might have been used by default. If you are interested, you can specify that. Then, you can go into some of the other details, results, the result summary. Now, you can see optimization path, recap of designs. Now, some of these results are not available, so I may have to run this exchanger design and rating once again under this. Say next. Say, do you want to run the program? Yes. Okay. So, there were some warnings. You can go into those details later. Now, you will be able to see some of the results now. Optimization path. Now, how many designs it has performed? About 6 different designs. You can see the variation. The shell size, 2 different shell sizes have been employed. And I think 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different tube lengths are used. Right? And it has, were there any tube passes? I think the tube passes were being changed from 1-1 heat exchanger, 1-2, 1-4. Number of shell passes. I think you will be able to see that shell passes in detail in the complete summary. Now, as you can see, it was able to also predict the total price of all these 6 exchangers, and it is trying to suggest what is the best possible exchanger based on the cost, $10,342. Now, that's what is the finally selected design as per the cost, which is giving you the exchanger with minimum cost. In fact, the same thing will be reported as your final design. 10,342, right? So you can see number of tube passes, number of tubes 46 in number, number of units in series, number of units in parallel. Now film coefficients on the shell side, overall film coefficient on the tube side. Now we'll go into some of these details, baffle spacing, pressure drop on the tube side, pressure drop on the shell side, so on, tube length required, like this. Now we can also look at the TAMA sheet. Now, as I said, some of these programs are quite competent, and the calculations handled by some of these packages are even accepted by industry standards. The only worry, if at all you have, could be what is the property estimation method you are using, whether there is any error in predicting those properties. If you can take care of an appropriate property method, now there cannot be any difference in the design performed by these models. So they are accepted by even fabricators or industry standards. Whatever details you want by the fabricator, all those details are available within this TAMA sheet. Now, you can go into the details, study what are the various details that are available. Now, in the same way, there is another format in which the same data is actually given, overall summary. Now, you can see thermal or hydraulic summary, heat transfer. Now, these are the coefficients. How did it know these coefficients? Now, these are some of the parameters that are involved in estimating these coefficients, right? If you want, you can also go into those details. The pressure drop calculations on both shell side and tube side. Mechanical summary. Now, exchanger geometry, so BEM, the details about the exchanger, horizontal alignment, baffle numbers, spacing, then tube length, tube number, tube type, right, things like that. Now, this is the beauty, setting plan and tube sheet layout. We said already 1-2 heat exchanger, and the number of tubes have been counted as 46. Now, in fact, if you want to do this as manually, allocating those number of tubes within a given shell diameter following the pitch and spacing could be a tedious job. You can really count this number, now there will be 46, right? And we said already it is a triangular pitch, 1-2. So that's why you can see this. So half of the tubes are on one side, the other half on the other side. Now this is the tube side, now you can expand. Similarly, I did not observe what was the number of baffles. The number of baffles as per the spacing, as per the cut, are actually given in a drawing form. Now these details can be sent to a fabricator, which he will be able to make use to calculate or fabricate that particular equipment. You can also see cost and weights. Now the total weight of the heat exchanger when it is empty is about 268.5 kg, when it is filled with water about 339.7, and this is the total cost. Now you can go into some of these details. Now I don't think we'll be able to make such zonal wise calculations with respect to properties, with respect to heat transfer. Now as you increase the number of intervals, the calculations become more and more tedious. Now we may not be able to even estimate those properties within such lower temperature ranges, and we will not be able to take care of the heat transfer that happens. Anyway, I request the students to go into each and every detail and address or identify what actually is happening, and try to show or try to see whether you will be able to make any modifications, whether some of the calculations, how they are actually done. Now I'd like to make one or two simple changes for you to show what could be its possible effect on the design. I'll go to the input. Now go to geometry, tubes. Now earlier we were doing it with 30 triangular pitch. Now I would like to change it to, let us say, 90 square. Okay, this is the only change I would like to make. In fact, if you want to design only a 1-1 heat exchanger, you can also force it. Though it has given you 1-2 heat exchanger based on the overall cost, for some reason, if you wanted to go with only 1-1, you can go ahead with that kind of a design. Now with this change, I would like to once again design the heat exchanger. I'd like to run the heat exchanger. Now I'd like to see what happened to my design. Now this is the variation. Earlier we were able to get the cost, the minimum cost happened to be 10,342. Now because of the modification that we have given, the cost has gone up to $10,539. Now you can also see the setting plan and tube sheet layout for this particular design. Now instead of a triangular pitch, we were able to select a square pitch. In fact, I did not observe what were the number of tubes, whether there was any increase or decrease. Now all these details you will be able to see. In fact, this can be taken as a printout, right? Same thing is true with respect to setting plan. If you increase or decrease the baffle spacing, now accordingly the number of baffles are going to be recalculated and they will be accordingly shown in your design. So I request the students, even while performing your project works, you can probably use this. Even though you have designed the heat exchanger using conventional manual methods, you can compare the design by performing this type of detailed calculations using one of these options. Thank you.